Check, check, 1, 2. So we say good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. We thank you for being here on time. And we just want to let you know that we're craving your patience for about 5 more minutes, and then we will begin. Is that okay? Please. Please and thank you. Please and thank you. We're throwing ourselves on your mercy. Thank you very much for your patience.
Good afternoon, everyone. And thank you very much for your patience. We are ready to begin. Let me welcome the chairman of the board of directors of Grace Kennedy Limited, Professor Gordon Shirley, the group chief executive officer of Grace Kennedy Limited, Senator Don Webby, the honorable minister of education, Senator Ruel Reid, members of the board of directors of Grace Kennedy Limited and the Grace Kennedy Foundation, our lecturer, Professor Marvin Reid, and members of his family, members of the diplomatic corps, representatives of the food and nutrition sector, members of the media, distinguished guests, colleagues, students, friends all, welcome. Food is an extremely important part of life. It's more important to others than to some than to others, but we eat because we must, in order to maintain life and health. We eat because food is delicious. We eat to celebrate the special moments of our lives. And today, more than ever, food has become a major element of entertainment as foodies travel the world to tantalize their taste buds with exotic dishes. We in Jamaica have a number of food festivals, and our restaurant scene grows daily. But even as some of us indulge ourselves, how many of us truly understand how the food we eat interacts with our bodies to provide the correct nutritional balance? This evening, our lecturer will help us to better understand the relationship between the food we eat and our bodies, with a focus on the extremes of nutritional maladaptation, those of obesity and undernutrition. So first off, let me extend a very special welcome to our lecturer, Professor Marvin Reid. Professor Reid is no stranger to our lecture series, as he has been a loyal attendee, and as one of the earliest recipients of the GraceKennedy Jamaica Scholarship, he has been in close touch with us for many, many years. When the GraceKennedy Foundation Lecture Committee decided to address the subject of nutrition, there was no doubt whatsoever about who the most appropriate candidate for lecturer would be. Welcome to directors and staff of the foundation and of our parent company, Grace Kennedy, who consistently supports the efforts of the foundation. We're happy to see those of you who have made this lecture a part of your annual activities and visit with us year after year. Significant members of this group are our secondary and tertiary students, their teachers and lecturers. Many of you have traveled miles into Kingston, and we feel privileged by the effort you have made to be here with us. I know that there are also many who are joining us for the very first time, and we bid you a very special welcome. I promise that you too will join our body of returning guests. We have a special group of students today that I would like to acknowledge. Leading up to the lecture, the Grace Kennedy Foundation launched the Choose My Plate online competition, which targeted schools that have a food and nutrition program. This afternoon, we have with us the winners of the competition for each county. The winning schools will receive $75,000 for equipment for their food and nutrition labs, and the students and their teachers will each receive $5,000 gift vouchers, compliments of high-low food stores. We welcome members of the media who will ensure that the debate about dietary choices continues in our print and electronic media. We are happy also to have a virtual audience, and we welcome those of you who are joining us via the internet stream. Thank you all for joining us this evening. We are confident that you will find the fair, satisfying, interesting, and thought-provoking, and look forward to a lively and stimulating discussion period. I now call on Mr. Radley Reid, a director of the Grace Kennedy Foundation and a member of the lecture committee, to introduce our lecturer. Professor Reid will then make his presentation. Thank you.
I endorse the protocol that has been established. Honorable Minister, Senator Webby, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, it is with great pride and pleasure that I introduce this evening's lecturer. With pride, not only because he is consummately qualified to address an issue of national and urgent importance, but more so because he is the embodiment of the intent of Grace Kennedy Foundation's work. One of the earliest recipients of the Grace Kennedy Jamaica Scholarship, in 1983, this young Arden graduate went on to study medicine at the University of the West Indies. His work since then has not only led to his distinguishing himself as an individual, but has contributed significantly to enriching the nation's capacity in the area of community health, family medicine, human metabolism, and of course, he is internationally recognized in his field. A very brilliant student, He gained the Bachelor of Medicine, Bachelor of Surgery degree, as well as a Doctor of Philosophy in Community Medicine from the University of the West Indies. This was followed by studies in clinical nutrition at the University of Southampton in the United Kingdom and postdoctoral studies at the Baylor College of Medicine in Texas. Professor Reid's substantial work has been with the Tropical Medicine Research Institute, TMRI as we know it, with which he has been associated since 1990. He was promoted to the rank of professor in 2009, and since 2013 has been the director of the Tropical Metabolism Research Unit, TMRU, an arm of TMRI. While the major function of TMRU is research, under Professor Reid's guidance and management, it has also provided clinical and laboratory services. Professor Reid has earned local and international recognition for his work. He is a key collaborator on several National Institute of Health grants and is a principal investigator on an important regional International Atomic Energy Agency grant supporting stable isotope assessment of breast milk intake and its effects on growth in infants. He currently administers grants totaling 3.8 million US. For a period of just under 10 years, Professor Reid served as the director of the sickle cell unit, and he continues to play a very important role in the Caribbean network of research on sickle cell disease. In addition to his considerable work in nutrition and sickle cell disease, Professor Reid has made a very significant contribution to undergraduate and postgraduate teaching in medical sciences at the University of the West Indies. He has contributed most significantly to international literature through the authorship and co-authorship of some 121 peer reviews in journals, as well as numerous other articles, abstracts, papers, and technical reports. He has also served as reviewer of a number of prestigious medical journals, including the West Indian Medical Journal. He has served as a member of the executive of the Medical Association of Jamaica since 2009, as vice president from 2013 to 2015, and chair of the Education Committee. Arden High School, his alma mater, also benefits from his strong commitment to national service. He is a board member at the Arden High School, and he was president of the Alumni Association in 2007. He's currently the president of the Rotary Club of Kingston, where he is true to its motto, service above self. I didn't know this, but Professor Reid is quite an athlete and sportsman. Very outstanding at Arden, and it continued at the university, where he won gold medals in long jump, in every inter-hall and intercollegiate competition, from 1984 to 1988. He has established the intercollegiate and mutual life games record in 1984 and an inter-university campus record in 1987. He was also named Sportsman of the Year for UW and represented Jamaica in track and field at the World University Games in long jump. He has also represented Jamaica in volleyball 1985 to 1995 at the Pan Am Games and the Caribbean Volleyball Championships, and was a member of the 1992 silver medal team that competed at the Caribbean Championships. Professor Reid is a certified International Volleyball Association Grade 1 coach and referee in volleyball. Professor Reid is the father of two children. Ladies and gentlemen, help me welcome our 2016 GraceKennedy Foundation lecturer, Professor Marvin Reid.
Thank you.
Okay, then. Let's see if I can get these things in order. Shift this a little bit over that side. Put this right here, and I'm good. Professor Elso Liorani, Master of Ceremonies, Senators, I see here Minister Rural Reid, Minister of Education and Information, Senator Webby, CEO Grace Group. I see my former boss, I'm told you're seconded, Professor Gordon Shirley. He's gone on to bigger and greater things with the Fourth Authority. And my family, Mommy, Antoinette, Fina, how are you doing? Members of the audience, good evening. You got a long introduction to me a while ago. And I could tell you, I could summarize that introduction in perhaps one line. Ladies and gentlemen, Marvin Reid, AOB. And for those of you who are not familiar with AOB, AOB means ardent whole boy. It's customary at this time for presenters to give a word of thanks. And typically when they're doing this, they usually start from upstairs and then come downstairs. So typically they would mention that they give thanks to God, they think thanks to family, they give thanks to colleagues. So I've just done that. But notwithstanding, I'd just like to thank the GraceKennedy Foundation for providing me the opportunity to engage with you all in a conversation that I'm very passionate about, and that is a conversation about nutrition and how it is that we should go about practicing nutrition. I must warn you that my background is in physiology, and as such, we will spend some time exploring, and physiology is really the science of trying to understand how the body works. So we'll spend some time trying to understand how nutrition works, because I believe that once you understand, then you're able to make some rational choices. On the slide, you'll see something that looks like a vegetable matter. And there's a penalty for sitting at the front whenever I'm giving a presentation. And that penalty is that I may call upon you to answer a question or two. Don't feel shy. There's no right or wrong. I've already given you all A's. You have an A for just coming through the door. So, any of my bright spark can tell me what we see there on this slide? okra. No, we're making some progress. So, albesmos, esculentus. So what's the significance of that? Well, essentially in 1983, on around October, I was called and told that I was being awarded the Grace Kennedy Scholarship, and I was invited to lunch with the then management team at the Grace Kennedy Company. Previous to this, in my house, as an adolescent, there were some kinds of foods that could not be served to me. Okra was one of them. On the menu at Grace Kennedy was a good old okra. One thing Mommy taught me was to be a very polite young man. So, with Mr. Diaz and company eating, I followed suit and had my okra. I then went home and told my family that I had to eat okra to get the scholarship. I like, when I'm doing nutrition experiments or nutrition lectures, to declare my interest. And I could say that I have no shares in any food company, well, except for Grace. But Grace Kennedy and I go back, I don't know, 1983, but prior to the scholarship, they were the first company that offered me a summer job. So they offered me a summer job and stationed me at the YMCA. They gave me a summer job for 2 weeks. And Sir Webby, they paid me the princely sum of 50 Jamaican dollars per fortnight. So for you young ones, that translates in today's dollars to about $3,400 per fortnight. So Grace Kennedy and I go back a good distance. The next slide really speaks to TMRU. And why have I put up a slide about TMRU? It's commonly accepted that Jamaica is well-renowned for culture and sports. But what is little appreciated is that Jamaica is well-renowned for science as well. And there's little celebration about this, and this is one of the sub-themes of my talk this evening, because most of the data that I'll be presenting comes from work that we have done at TMRU. And I make no apologies for that. I think we've done some good work. We recognize that up north, there are some people who, as part of their campaign, is proclaiming that they want to make America great. But I have some news for him. Jamaica has beat him to the punch. We're already great. So, in discussing the talk this evening, I thought, like a good lecturer, Professor Elser would be very proud of me. I've stated what my objectives are. We will be discussing under a few themes. So, what is nutrition? I'll also be introducing to you the concept of human nutrition as a demand-led process. And for the students, that's perhaps a little bit more important. I'll be discussing and characterizing the state of the nutritional state of Jamaicans, both those that are overnourished and undernourished. I'll list some of the frequencies, or discuss the prevalence, causes, and consequences. And finally, I will try to help us understand how it is we go about understanding what the dietitians or the physicians may recommend for us, the whole concept of a nutritional prescription. So we will start by defining what is human nutrition. And for us, human nutrition represents the interface, the interaction between human nutrition and metabolic demand. So any factor that affects this interaction is basically what we would consider to be a component of human nutrition. Classically, we can divide those factors as being factors that are intrinsic to the individual, as well as factors that are external to the individual, so-called environmental factor. So under individual factors, we think about your genes, and this is not the Calvin Klein type, but certainly the genes that determines what you will become. We also think about a stage just distal to that, which is gene expression, and I will explain some more as I go along what that means. Where you are in life, your mood, your appetite, and whether or not you have any disease at all. Certainly, on the environmental side, some of the factors that may impact on this interaction includes their culture and personal beliefs, food access or food security, economic factors, climate change, and of course, government policies. And I'm happy to see that I have at least two government members here. So when we talk about genetic factors, you have to understand what are the things that constitute your genes. And typically within a cell, you have, in human cells at least, you have 23 pairs of chromosomes. Each of these chromosomes has what we consider to be genes, and each gene has what we call nucleotides that makes up the gene. So the genes contain or possesses in it their genetic information, which is really the information how to make specific proteins. And the process by which the body transcribes this information is called initially transcription, and from that you make what is called a messenger RNA. So that's what you'll see, if my mouse will come on. Right, this is what you'll see here. And then that messenger RNA is translated into your respective protein molecule. So the challenge, therefore, then, is that in order for the gene to influence your phenotype or influence what you become, it has to be translated. And just as some people may have difficulty in understanding someone from another language, even though you may have an interpreter, similar things can occur within the cells. And we recognize that there are certain factors, both physical and chemical factors, that can produce or make changes to this gene or into this translation process without necessarily making any alteration to the DNA itself. Those processes or changes are what we refer to as epigenetic changes. So this slide illustrates this in a little bit more. So on the top end, you'll see what we say that you can have changes that occur to the nucleotides themselves. Typically, those changes involve the addition of a methyl group, and we call it DNA methylation. Secondly, you may have problems with what we call the regulatory component. So your mRNA may be the subject of some degree of control. And finally, when you make your proteins, the proteins in itself can become modified thereafter. So it has what we call post-translational effects. So why have I gone through all of this detail? Well, basically, we have, from rat experiments, and more recently in human experiments, information that suggests that not only is your genes important, but whether or not the genes are read are equally important in terms of the ability to manifest itself in terms of disease. And this is important because one of the environmental factors which can modulate or affect whether or not the genes are expressed has to do with nutrition. So some people have a fear for these little creatures here that we call rodents, but they're actually very important tools to us. On the extreme left is what is called a agouti mice. And this mice has particular characteristics. He tends to be quite fat, and his coat tends to be quite yellow. On the far right is the so-called pseudo-agouti mice. And this one is the one that tends to be lean, and he or she typically does not have any major illnesses and live quite long. And what we've been able to demonstrate is that we can get these kind of what we call phenotypes, these kinds of rats, by feeding the mommy different diets when the rat's mother is pregnant. All right? So essentially then, when the baby mice is born, we can actually determine or produce one by feeding mommies different kinds of diets. And the question is, okay, so that's good in mice, but does it happen in humans? And the short answer is yes. We now have data to say that if a mommy is pregnant and consumes diet that are rich in folate-containing foods, then we can demonstrate that when we take her her genes or take samples from her genes, there's excessive methylations of that genes. And that can translate, excess methylation in the fetal genes, and that can translate into difference in terms of the outcome of the baby. We all appreciate that as we age, we go through what is considered to be several life stages. So clearly we start from infancy, go through to childhood, go through to adulthood. One of the issues that we have, or one of the things that we have found, is that events that may occur in the earlier phase may have a domino effect throughout in the later phase. And so what we can say is that there's now a wide body of evidence that poor nutrition at any phase, but especially at the early stage, can have persistent effects through the later stage and predispose individuals to getting particular chronic diseases. To test some of these ideas, in about 1992-93, the TMRU started a study which we call the TMRU Vulnerable Windows Cohort Study. And in this particular study, we went over to the antenatal clinic and we recruited 712 women, all pregnant. We followed all of these women throughout the course of their pregnancy until delivery. And we have subsequently been following up the offsprings of these children, of these women, as well as the mom themselves. So, in the overall study, we ended up with roughly about 569 mother-baby combinations, which we have studied. And what have we found? Well, when we looked at the children when they were age 12, we found some interesting results. One of which was that their birth size, those babies that were products of mommy, that had reasonable sized birth weight, ended up having what we call more truncal obesity, more belly fat when they were age 12. We also recognized that how the babies were fed subsequent to their birth, especially between 0 to 6 months, also predisposed them to having other cardiovascular intermediate factors, such as a higher blood pressure, as well as waist circumference. And similarly, their growth pattern between years 2 to 11 also affected their cardiovascular risk. So we say this to say that essentially how a pregnant mom is fed, as well as subsequent feeding whilst the child is growing, will contribute ultimately to the predisposition of a child or an individual to get some of what we call the chronic cardiovascular disorders. We all recognize that mood affects how we eat. Those of us will recognize that once it is that we become hungry, we become quite irritable. The physiological mechanism behind that is, of course, the fact that there is a relationship between some of the chemicals that the gut produces and the brain. Those individuals who have what we call the extremes of eating disorders, the anorexia nervosa and the bulimia, we think represent a preponderance of what we call negative somatic symptoms, and therefore this is manifested in this particular eating problem. We also know that certain chemicals in food affects our mood, and we can produce these in experimental situations. So, for example, the omega-3 fatty acid, tryptophan, folate, and some of the B vitamins in lab studies do directly affect your mood. Your appetite is another area of concern. We recognize that there are what we call some signals in the body that stimulates hunger, so we call these orexigenic signals, and we have some signals that stimulates fullness or satiety, and we call that anorexigenic signals. The appetite center in the brain is the center that controls whether you feel hungry or whether you feel full. And that receives inputs from many sources, chief of which is from your gut, but also from other areas in your brain. We also recognize that in some disorders, dysfunction of your appetite can exacerbate or make these disorders worse, as well as it may even contribute to the disorder manifesting itself. So for example, many of us are familiar with relatives or friends who may have cancer. And one of the features of terminal cancers is that no matter what, they don't eat. And so we recognize that in these particular conditions, the control of the appetite center is gone awry. So when we speak about lifestyle, which is the sixth individual factor, we're really talking about the balance of activity between work and leisure, as well as the consumption of socially accepted drugs such as alcohol and tobacco. Notice I haven't put marijuana here, but it might soon reach the list. So this we know directly affects whether or not we eat or don't eat. I've already mentioned the effect of disease, and disease operates by either increasing your metabolic rate, affecting your appetite, affecting your ability to digest or absorb food, as well as your ability to metabolize food. When we start talking about the environmental factors, our own beliefs affect whether or not we eat and that interaction. So the sociologists propose a concept they call norms, which is really our understanding of what is expected of us as acceptable behavior. And we think that these norms allow us to choose foods that are safe, facilitate food sharing, as well as to facilitate food choices. Climate change is a big issue. Just driving over, there's a news alert that the 2015 was the hottest year. 2016 is likely to break that. And February, the change in the Earth's temperature was about 1.5 degrees Celsius more. The long and short is that climate change affects food production and food security. And we're all familiar that after any natural disaster, whether it be a hurricane or famine, that there may be, or even war, there may be issues with food availability and food security. A very touchy topic, but public policy. Policies are generally effected through a combination of laws, taxations, and incentives. There's been a move afoot internationally, and some countries in the Caribbean have actually started to follow suit, which is to, since it is that a lot of the obesity problems in countries are thought to be due to increased consumption of sugar-sweetened beverages, to try and see if we can dissuade individuals from consuming those things. And one method of doing it is to make it more expensive to purchase. And so some institutions or some states, jurisdictions, have instituted what they call a sugar tax. Within the Caribbean, Barbados has decided to follow the international trend, and they introduced a sugar tax last year. Jamaica is not there yet. So, to summarize where we are now, essentially what we have said so far is that human nutrition represents the interaction between your dietary input as well as what we call your metabolic demand. And we have discussed some of the factors that may affect the things that go in. Briefly, we discussed your genes and their expression, your mood, your appetite, lifestyle, and diseases. On the extrinsic or environmental side, we discuss culture, climate change, and public policy. So when you eat, essentially your diet then will provide you with what we consider to be nutrients as well as other compounds. For the purposes of this lecture, we will focus mainly on the nutrients, but clearly when we're talking about the relationship between nutrition and cancer, the other compounds become very important. On the nutrient side, what we're talking about is what we call macronutrients, carbohydrates, lipids, vitamins, minerals, and trace elements. So what does your diet do? Essentially, it's like the gas in your motor car. It's really a fuel. So therefore, your macronutrients, the purpose of it is really to act as a fuel to allow the body to function. The additional functions, especially for trace elements and vitamins, is the provision of what we call specific nutrients to engage in specific reactions. An important concept that is related to the function of your diet is the so-called concept of turnover. And what that concept basically speaks to is that at no time, but at every time, there's always a consistent building up and breaking down of molecules within the body. So that's a very important process. So that process really leads us to the whole concept of what we call metabolic demand. And your metabolic demand is really the energy requirements for your body. And we define metabolic demand into two main components, the so-called basal component and a so-called variable component. And when your metabolic demand is equal to your intake, we see that you're at balance. So on the slide here, we have a volunteer who is having her, looks like a she, who's having her basal metabolic demands being measured. So the variable component of this metabolic demand involves the energy that is used to digest the food, the energy that is expended in physical activity, the energy that is used to maintain your body temperature, as well as the energy that is used for growth, especially in the pediatric population. And what we say is that this demand must be equal to your input. And in order for you to satisfy this demand, you must have the adequate supply of nutrients at the right place, the right time, or in adequate amounts. If there's any mismatch between the metabolic demand and your nutrient supply, there's always a consequence, and this consequence is that you will either change in body shape and size, so that we say that you change in form, as well as function. And so this comes to this my second school challenge quiz. And what is my second school challenge quiz? Simply put, it's this. Let me see those of you who eat at least 3 times for the day. Excellent. Let me see those of you who eat at least 6 times for the day. No, no, none for 6? Let me see those of you who consume just 1 for the day. Okay, all right. So here's the question now. Here's the question now. Let us assume that my body needs to make a particular chemical. Let's say we want to make a particular protein. I have 2 choices to make that protein. I can either get it from my muscles, you know, I can break it down from my muscles, or I can get it from a nice piece of steak that I've just had to eat. Where do you think would be the preferred choice for my body to get the chemicals I need? You have 1 of 2 choices, like Christianity. You can either choose God or not God. So the issue is you can either get it from your body or you can get it from food. Let me see those of you who think it's from the body. Okay. Let me see those of you who think it's from the food. Oh, Fina, you think it's from food? All right. Wrong. Remember, I prefaced my first comment by asking how many people had food 3 or 4 times for the day. I got a few hands and went up to 6 times. The basis of that is that you eat intermittently, right? Nobody eats continuously. You eat intermittently. We said that you always had a metabolic demand. The only time you have a metabolic demand of 0 is when you're dead. All right? So it means that at every single second, your body has to be providing for itself. So in truth and in fact, it cannot wait until you eat. You actually, when you eat, is replacing food that your body has already used. All right? So in essence, the things that determine how your body works is really how you're structured. All right? So, and the answer is on the slide. Your metabolic demand is a continuous process. It never stops. It never sleeps. Some people would like to think that their bank is like that. It never stops. It never sleeps. Do you have a bank? Oh, isn't that so? Right. So your metabolic demand is always a continuous entity. Your diet, however, is intermittent. And hence, to satisfy your metabolic demand, your immediate source of supply always comes from your body. We therefore eat to replenish our body stores. So it means, therefore, that if our body stores is not adequate, we may end up with a mismatch. And there's a functional cost to that. We may continue to lose weight. So you have gotten the first part of what we call the principles of nutrition. So we all are now on the same page. So now we can then now move to trying to understand the whole concept of what we call overnutrition and undernutrition and how they are in Jamaica. The first thing first is that as nutritionists, we like to assess your status. And there are certain tools that we use or have at our disposal to make some assessment of your status. One of these tools is to measure what we consider to be your body proportions or your body dimensions. And so we'll do things like your height, your weight. We'll measure circumferences such as your mid-upper arm circumference or even your waist circumference. We can assess what we call the chemical components in your body. So we can look, for example, at the concentration of certain proteins like albumin or retinal binding protein or some other chemical. We can use imaging techniques, so we can do what is called a DEXA scan or an ultrasound or an MRI, and those can tell us, you know, how much muscle you have, how much fat you have, and where they are. We may also use what we call biophysical techniques. So these are techniques that are based on physics principles, and the one most commonly used is what is called a bioelectrical impedance measurement. Some of us may be familiar with this because some of us buy some scales, and when we stand on those scales, it tells us what percent of body fat we have. It's really using what we call these biophysical principles to give an estimate as to the amount of fat. Traditionally, when we do a nutritional survey, the unit we use, or the measure that we use, often is what is called your body mass index, or BMI. And we compute your BMI by having your weight in kilograms divided by your height in meters squared. And the World Health Organization and the international community has agreed that if your BMI and you're an adult is below 18.5, we consider it to be underweight. If it's 18.5 to 24.9, then you're considered to be normal or healthy weight. So if you look at me, I'm still in the normal and healthy weight category. If you're above that, so you're between 25 to 29.9, we consider you to be overweight. So you're getting fluffy. And if you're 30 and above, then you're really fluffy. So those are the internationally agreed criteria. Now, the issue, though, is that BMI is not a perfect measure. So individuals may have similar BMI, but have different degrees of body fat. So even though we may come from the same ancestry, and this is a study that we participated with, and you may not be able to see it so good, but suffice it to say that this is for the males and this is for the females, that below here, there's a yellow line that comes here. And these are the black people in Nigeria. And then above that blue line is the people in Jamaica. And above that is the black people in the U.S. And you see a vertical line here. So all of these individuals have a BMI of 25. But clearly, the Jamaican have more body fat than the Nigerian, and those black people in the US with the same BMI have more body fat than the Jamaicans. And so this is how it's classical is. That is, individuals in the Jamaican system, we tend to be intermediate between our ancestors our colleagues in Africa, compared to the ones in the U.S. Despite the fact that it is not a perfect predictor of body fat, in field studies, if we consider it to be a reasonable good factor of body fatness, when it is, then we look at it at a population level. And so when we do our surveys, we actually do your height and weight and measure your BMI, and then we use that to give us an index as to how much fat or what proportion of people are fat within a particular population. So I'm going to report here using data from the Jamaica Health and Lifestyle Survey, and the last one that we did was in 2008. We are still scheduled to do one for 2016. I know the budget hasn't passed it, but I think the money is still there. And hopefully we will be able to update some of these figures. So the Jamaica Health and Lifestyle Survey was headed by Professor Rainford Wilkes, who happened to be one of my PhD supervisors. Professor Wilkes, some of you may know, had the distinction of attending that school on North Street. There's more than one? Yeah, no, he actually went to KC. Those of you who know. But nevertheless, he has led his team admirably, and some of these results are really testimony to the hard work that he did. Suffice it to say, if you look in the overweight category, you will see that roughly about 25% of both males and females on that survey, and this was a national survey, so we went to every nook and cranny across the country to measure people. And you could see that roughly about 25% of the samples that he measured were overweight. When we talk about the fluffy people, the females far outnumber the men. So roughly about 35% of the females were considered to be really fluffy. So when you add both overweight and obesity together, we have that over half of the sample were overweight and obese. Having said that, we also have a significant proportion of the population, somewhere about 45% of the population, who would be considered to be undernourished. And the sample aged from between age 15 to age 74. So clearly then, Jamaica is faced with both extremes, a population that of which half of which are either overweight and obese, and a significant portion, or roughly about 45%, who in adulthood are undernourished. So combined, almost 60% of the population has significant nutritional issues. So, as I mentioned, come on, volume. All right, strong obesity is also a problem, all right? 70% of women with central obesity, we found, have had strong obesity, as well as about 20% of the men, all right? Right, all right, Admiral Bailey, all right? The challenge you have with trunk obesity is that it's also a risk factor for cardiovascular disorder. And as a matter of fact, some people think, don't like to use the term, but it's actually the worst kind of fat to have. I see my colleague, Professor Boyne, in the audience. He likes to use the term adiposity. What's that big term you use? Yeah, keep it simple. All right. So let's talk some money now. I see Senator Weber in here, and here he's a money man. Between 2000 and 2010, the economists estimate that just looking at two of the outcomes of obesity, which is hypertension and diabetes, Jamaica spent upwards of or close to 6% of GDP just to deal with just those two issues. Trinidad spent a little bit more than us. That's because they had oil money. In another year or two, it's going to be below us because they don't have no more oil. But that's another question. What does that 6% of GDP translate to? Essentially, it translates to roughly about 80 billion Jamaican dollars per year just to deal with these two particular conditions. In 2014, we were all excited about chickpea because we all got our little pains and we were already bending up on stuff, and the private sector came out and said, chickpea cost us $7 billion or 0.5% of GDP. But I'm here to tell you that whilst it was costing 0.5% of GDP, hypertension and diabetes was causing us $80 billion or 6% of your GDP. So which one do you think is more important? Minister? All right. So the long and short is that they represent a significant burden on the health system. In fact, there was a study done by the what they call the Global Burden of Diseases, and they list the cardiovascular diseases, hypertension, diabetes, ischemic heart disease as affecting in terms of the effect on what they call disability life years as in the top five in the Jamaican context, and was responsible for about 25% of the health burden. For the country. So the long and short about it is that it's not as dramatic. It doesn't cause it to have pain and crimple up and stuff. It doesn't scare people much because it's very insidious, but the long and short is that it's a very expensive proposition for us. So I've spent some time discussing the whole issue of what happens in adulthood. But what about children? Children are just as significant in the scheme of things. The estimates that we have, which are relatively old, says that in the Jamaican context, roughly about 6% of our children are probably overweight. Many Caribbean countries, including Jamaica, as I said, are observing this increased prevalence in obesity. Now, when it is that we look for the rest of the Caribbean, some of the more recent estimates puts it at about 28 to 35% in some of the Caribbean countries. The particularly alarming issue in Jamaica, though, is that when we looked at obesity in children, say, 7 to 8 years, and then we measured them again when they're about 11 to 12 years, we found that the rates were moving from anywhere from about 3.5 when they were 7 to about 9.5% when they're about 11 to 12. So in essence, then, as they're getting older, they're getting fatter. So I mentioned that our data suggested that we're probably about 6% overweight. The global data suggests that on an average, if we average out most countries, in children 0 to 5, the global prevalence is about 4.2%. So it says that within the Jamaican context, we are actually above the global figures. So it's a cause for concern. So essentially, not only are we talking about obesity in the old folks, but we also, our children, are getting fatter. So we look at dietary intakes now. So why are we getting fat? We tend to do studies comparing people who are fat versus people who are not so fat and look at what it is that they're consuming. For the most part, we have not been able to distinguish or determine that there are any major differences in terms of the gross energy intake between those of us who are fat versus those of us who are not so fat. We then decided to say, okay, is it some component of the diet itself? Is it that we're eating too much carbohydrate? Is it that we're eating too much fat relative to other ingredients? And so this data comes from some PhD work from one of our students, Dr. Smith, who sampled some individuals from Hope Pastures because they're near to us and they look, the houses look kind of big, so we think they're a little bit affluent. And then we went to St. Mary on the banana plantation, and then we sampled some individuals. They were hard working, chopping down the bananas and stuff. And then we looked at what both groups of individuals ate. And the long and short about it is that really and truly there's not much difference between their energy intakes. So here you'll see urban female and urban males. This is roughly where it is. And if you look at rural females and rural males, you see that roughly there's no much difference between them. So clearly the country people and the town people are eating the same thing. When we look at it in terms of the specific subgroups, carbohydrates, as well as fat, there's really no difference. So in summary then, what we're saying is that there are no major difference in the dietary pattern between persons living in rural communities and urban communities. What we did find, however, was that in both communities, things like vegetable and fruit consumptions were extremely low. In fact, we found that roughly about 90% of Jamaicans eat less than the recommended 3 servings of either fruits and vegetables in a day. So, as we said, people gain weight. And the reasons why they gain weight has to do with the fact that the balance between what they put in and what they expend in terms of physical activity is uneven, in that they expend less than what they do to gain weight. So let's look at physical activity. When we talk about physical activity, we talk about 2 main components, what is called non-exercise activity thermogenesis. And people may ask what that is, but really that's energy that you expend doing volunteer activities such as walking, that's ambulation, your posture, your voluntary activity. So you know, for example, that I have a lot of NEAT because even though I'm talking to you, I'm moving my hands all over the place, and so I'm getting some exercise. Exercise activity thermogenesis refers to purposeful exercise. So those of us who go to do a workout or have play a sport, that's what we consider to be some degree of exercise activity thermogenesis. It is thought, for example, that individuals who may be predisposed to obesity, when it is that their neat energy is relatively low. So I mentioned the survey before, the Jamaica Health and Lifestyle Survey in 2008. And here what we found was that the inactivity patterns across the samples was actually fairly high. And more males were a little bit more active than females. And so we think that perhaps it is the imbalance in physical activity between the two groups that may be contributing to the differential in obesity patterns between males and females. Of particular concern to us is that when we look at what we call weight change per year, one of the things that is a bit worrisome for us is that the group of individuals that is showing the most rapid change in weight are the people who have relatively normal BMI. So here we see that individuals who have relatively normal BMI of less than 25, they are gaining weight of about 2.4 kilos per year, which translates to roughly about 5 pounds per year. So this is like compound interest. If you start at 120 and you put on 5 pounds in each year, so in 10 years, you will be 170. So you then move from a normal weight to a very fluffy weight. So we have spent some time looking at the obesity issue. So what about the undernutrition issue? Well, the first thing first is that when we talk about undernutrition, we like to speak about undernutrition both in adults as well as in children. And I showed you some data initially about undernutrition in adults being about 4 to 5%. To understand it a little bit more clearly in children, one of the things that we use is what is called a growth curve. So those of you who have small children and take them to the health center, you will see that sometimes the doctors plot them on these little charts. And suffice to say, what we do is that if you're above the middle line, you're considered to be doing very well. And if you're below the middle line, you're considered to be doing fairly badly. And so this schematic diagram really represents the different types of undernutrition as we know them in children. So in essence, you can either be normal, in which case you have normal weight for height and your age. You can be wasted, in which case the wasted term in Jamaica is at your mager. Or you can be stunted, you're really short or downgrow. Or you could be underweight. All right, so these are the respective criteria. Stunting is particularly challenging because stunting tends to represent what we call chronic or long-term undernutrition. And we recognize that it is associated with increased rates of illness, death, reduced cognitive function, school achievement, and adult work capacity. And additionally, as they get older, they get increased heart problems and other diseases. Most persons in the world would agree that you can reduce stunting in the population by what we call a package of intervention. And this package of intervention consists of breastfeeding, appropriate weaning foods, may have to supplement them with some additional food, and all of these activities, when you put them together, will reduce what we call the prevalence of stunting. So let's talk about breastfeeding. So the Ministry of Health employs all of these midwives, right? And one of the functions of midwives is to assist and care, provide what we call maternal and child health services. And so when mommies go to what we call a six-week clinic, one of the standard questions that are asked is, Mom, how do you feed your babies? Essentially then, what the ministry says is that on an average, the women who attend at 6 weeks at any of the public health facilities report that roughly about 50% of them breastfeed. And is that good? Well, perhaps. Well, this is what they report. However, we're a bit concerned about the fact that, about the, what we call the growth pattern in our children. So we decided to go and test them. So we decided that instead of asking mommy whether or not they breastfed or not, because one of the things with mommies is that they don't like to disappoint the doctor. So if they know the right answer, they're going to tell it the right answer. So what we do is that we give mommies water to drink, but it's a special water. It's a water that has something we call deuterium in there. And when she drinks the deuterium, it mixes with her body water and then comes in the breast milk. So when the baby sucks from titty, or sucks from breast, the baby will get the special water or the deuterium. And we can test whether or not the baby has the deuterium by taking a salivary sample from the baby. And so when we do that, we can actually estimate how much milk that baby has sucked. And what we find is that at 6 weeks, remember I told you what the ministry data says, 50%, only a third of the women, when measured, actually are breastfeeding exclusively at 6 weeks. Remember what I said about breastfeeding? It's perhaps one of the most important factors to reduce the incidence of prevalence, or reduce the prevalence of stunting in children. And why is stunting important? Because it makes them, people who are stunted tend to be dunser than people who are not stunted. So, the fact remains, therefore, that one easy and simple public health activity that we can do, we're not doing so well at it. So we can also measure, and this is what we did, we actually measured the quantity of breast milk that the baby got, as well as the various components of that breast milk that the baby is receiving. And what we can see here is that those women in this column who are exclusively breastfeeding are actually giving the baby more breast milk and more protein from breast milk, which is not surprising. The significant thing is that when we look at the growth of the babies, they're different. So babies who are breastfed actually are growing differently from babies who are not breastfeeding. And so the significance of all of this is that we think that ultimately, as the baby ages, we are putting some of our infants at increased risk of what we call cardiovascular disease. So a take-home message, mommies, is please breastfeed your babies. A severe form of undernutrition in children is the so-called kwashiorkor syndrome, as well as the marasmic syndrome. And I like to talk about this particular one because of the fact that in textbooks, you will see that it is written that these diseases are caused by protein deficiencies in the diet. And I want to tell everyone that if you are my student and you write that, you'll get zero. The long and short is that we know it's far more complex than that. And the TMRU has spent roughly about 60 years just researching this particular problem. I must tell you, as an anecdote, that the term kwashiorkor, as it relates in the English literature, actually was given, or this disease was actually named by a Jamaican. You knew that? Right. Dr. Cicely Williams, in the 1930s, actually coined the term kwashiorkor. I tell you, we'll look a bit more with Talawa. So this disease is of particular significance to us. What we have found in our labs, really, is that this disease is really due to, or one of the major contributing factors, is really the imbalance between your antioxidant capacity of the body as well as your oxidative stress. And one of the major antioxidants in your body is this tripeptide called glutathione. And what we have found is that we can cause the body to improve or increase the synthesis of these glutathione molecules by giving them an appropriate supplement. And so we give them cysteine supplements to actually achieve this. And not only do they make more glutathione, but they actually get better faster. And so this is one of the things that we have done to ensure that we can save most of these severely malnourished kids and let them recover faster. So in addition to the fact that they have poor quality diet, and in addition to the fact that they have an imbalance between their oxidative stress as well as their antioxidant capacity, we also believe that there's perhaps a fundamental metabolic problem between those individuals who end up getting marasmus as well as versus those individuals who get kwashiorkor. So remember I told you that what a mommy consumed during the time she was pregnant also affected how the baby came out at the end. And it is thought that mommies who produce infants that are of normal weight are mommies that are getting the right kind of nutrients during pregnancy. The challenge for that, though, is that the baby don't get in a hard life. So the baby has not adapted or doesn't come out with the with what we call the metabolic machinery to adapt to hard life. Mommy, who had a hard life and didn't eat so well during pregnancy and produced an infant who was a much lower birth weight, but that baby came out adapted for hard life. So when he's faced with adverse circumstances, instead of he becoming kwashiorkor and having that positive, he may just become quite mager. And so what we did was we then went back and looked at all the babies that we admitted over the last 30, 40 years to see if there were differences in their birth weight. And lo and behold, what we found was that those babies who had a bad intrauterine experience turned out to have had lower birth weight and turned out to have had the syndrome we call marasmic compared to the individuals who ended up with kwashiorkor. So this further reinforces the belief that individuals who end up with these syndromes perhaps have three major issues. One is that based on what mommy endowed them with, and that affected their metabolic profile, the poor quality diet, and an imbalance between their oxidative capacity that led them to become sick as they are. What contributes to poor quality diet? Well, we all recognize that snacking, this more modern phenomenon, contributes a lot to poor quality diet. So for example, on my right here, this is supposed to have been water, or is it? So a lot of people now are replacing the good old natural water with colored water. But what happened to the colored water? As you can see here, this bottle of colored water provides you with an extra 56 calories. All right? So not only is voluntarily, because we actually drink it voluntarily, consuming a lot of fluids that contain extra sugar. It is not surprising that when we actually estimate the amount of energy that is contributed by a snack, we find that up to a third of a lot of children's energy intake is provided by what we call these kind of snacks, which have no other essential nutrients. And this year, I passed through a local supermarket and just took a shelf. As you can see, there's quite a lot of things to choose from, but they all characteristically have lots of energy and nothing else to them. So to summarize, what we can say is that a person is undernourished, has a mismatch between their intakes and their metabolic demand. Overweight is common, both in children and in adults. We accept that truncal obesity is another contributing factor. We also accept that within the Jamaican context, both wasting and stunting and other forms of undernutrition are both common. We recognize that there are no major differences in the dietary patterns between our rural areas and our urban areas. So essentially, Jamaica is a pan country where everybody's eating roughly the same things, and that consistently in both sets of individuals or both sets of communities, vegetable and food consumptions are low. So I'm going to go through fairly quickly some of these slides. And really what we're discussing here is the different kinds of food groups. How many of you have gone to purchase some food from a restaurant and they will ask you, after they've given you the rice or whatever it is that they're giving you, and they've given you some meat, and you reach the vegetable section, they ask you, do you want vegetable or pasta? Right. So in essence, what they're doing is replacing all your vegetables with more carbohydrates. All right? So Jamaica is one of those countries that equate pasta with vegetables. So clearly, there's some mix-up between what we consider an understanding of the various food groups. So quickly speaking, from our side, we say that you have cereals and staples, legumes, vegetables, fruits, food from animals, fats, oils. Those are the main food groups. The Ministry of Health has actually created what we call a food-based dietary guideline to try and assist us in making rational choices for our foods. And I would encourage, it's available on their website, if you can't get the book, I'll encourage everyone to have a read of it. So your staples, it will include your starchy fruits, you know, your flour, your bananas, your breadfruit, all of those stuff. An important concept with starch, though, has to do with this whole concept of what we call glycemic index, which basically is just a measure of how much and a quantity of this food raises your blood sugar. So to give you some rough ideas, cassava is almost as good as glucose in raising your blood glucose levels. That's why it has a high glycemic index. And your good old breadfruit has a relatively low glycemic index. Your glycemic index is not the only thing. We also talk about what we call glycemic load, which is the glycemic index plus the amount that you consume. So even though you may eat a low glycemic index food like breadfruit, if you had the whole breadfruit, you would increase your blood sugar numbers quite high. Then we come about your vegetables. The important thing for your vegetables provides your fiber, your iron, and some vitamins. And the most important thing is the last bullet point. And what does the last bullet point say? It is affected by heat. And so fruits and vegetables, especially vegetables, are best consumed raw. But most of us like to go and boil out every living thing out of it, and then we consume it. And all we're getting is trash or fiber. All right? So that's essentially what you do. Fruits are a good source of vitamin C especially, and potassium. All right, your legumes are your peas and your beans and nuts, all right? So that's basically what it does. It provides you with high fiber. It doesn't contain all your amino acids, so you probably will have to eat additional sources of protein to get all the protein that you would need. Food from animals, so your meat, your poultry, your fish. And the big concern here now when we talk about food is the so-called apartheid system. You know what's the apartheid system? This is red meat versus the white meat. You heard about that one? Yeah, man. So some people say, I only eat white meat. And some people may say, I only eat red meat. And some people who are red want to be white. So, you know, you have the pork people who want it to become white. And the question then is, what is red and what is white? Part of that problem has to do with the professionals not having a very clear definition of what is red and what is white. But typically, from a biological standpoint, any meat from a mammal is red, all right? And any meat from a non-mammal, so from a bird, is usually considered to be white meat. The pork people have a lobby, so what they want to say is that the redness is due to something called myoglobin. And since your myoglobin content is relatively low, they want to call it white meat. So they call it the other white meat. But the long and short about it is, it's red meat. All right, fats and oil, one of the things, a good source of that, of course, is our good old ackee and our pear. The next thing is really to understand what we mean by servings, because a serving to me might mean a different serving to you. If you ever go to some of these shops that sell food, you'd always hear the people quarreling with this, with that, with the servers to say they want more of this and they want more of that. So their concept of what a serving is clearly is warped. And what this slide was trying to show, even though it's not showing so well, is really what constitutes a serving. And a serving is going to be dependent upon the food group. So there's no fixed definition for it. So for example, if we're talking about a staple such as your carbohydrate source, one slice of bread would be considered to be a serving. If you were talking about your vegetable source, then we would consider it to be a cup of vegetable. If you're talking about a serving of milk, it would be half a cup of milk, or about four ounces. If you're talking about meat, most of us is like a chicken leg would consider to be a serving. But most of you want three pieces, so you go to Kentucky, buy a big deal. But that's not a serving. That's three servings. All right? So the challenge we have is to really understand what we mean by portion sizes. So the next quiz now, I have about four quiz. So this is the next one. Which one of these have more calories, the one on the left or the one on the right? Remember, I'm not a policeman, so you can choose anyone you want. The one on the left? Okay, the short answer is that both of them are equivalent. So a good resource or a good tool for those of you who still believe in reading is a so-called Caribbean calorie counter. That's a reasonably good book that will have most of the foods that we consume in Jamaica that you can look at, and it will basically be able to tell you, give you some guide as to what the calorie contents. For those of you who don't like reading and have smartphones and have computers, MyFitnessPal is another website that can provide useful tools or useful information to help you in terms of making your choices. So how much do you need? This table really just gives you a rough idea of how much calories that you basically need, how much energy that you basically need if you're a girl or woman. And basically it's dependent upon your activity pattern. So for most women, you recognize that you really don't need more than about 2,000 calories per day if you want to remain weight neutral. As I said, infants are much less. If you're a male, and you're in my age group, which is down the bottom here, you realize that you only need about 2,008 or thereabout of calories to maintain weight neutrality. So in order for you to understand how you get that, you have to understand how to read the labels. So Grace Kennedy, they have their food labels put on, and all the food manufacturers have great food labels put on. And the important thing is that you have to start reading first with the serving size. So the first thing that you look at in the label is to find out what the serving size is that it says. All right? And I'll give you an example later on about the serving size. The next thing, then, you look at the things down this bottom side, this curve. These things you want to be in low numbers, all right? And these things down this bottom panel you want to get in high numbers. So this is some guessing time now. So if you take this little round bun, if you take this little round bun and you look at it, it will tell you that a serving size is actually 1/3 of a bun. I challenge you, you go and you get the round bun and you look at it, it will tell you that the serving size is 1/3 of a bun. And it will proudly display that a serving has 160 calories. All right? So if you take this round bun and think that you're only going to get 160 calories, you're going to get a fat awakening. So what it means is that just from this bun alone, you're going to get 480 calories. Then when you add the cheese, and I won't tell you which cheese to use, that's Mr. Webby here. But when you add the cheese to it, you're roughly getting about another 100 calories. So remember I told you, an average female needs how many? 2,000. And an average male needs probably about 3,000. So if they have a poor man burger, you know what's a poor man burger? Bun and cheese. So if they have a poor man burger, how many poor man burgers are they allowed? In the case of the woman, 4. And in the case of the man, 5. And that's it for the day. So clearly, nobody eats that small amount. So clearly what's going to happen is that we're going to have people getting fatter. So this slide is courtesy of my colleague, Dr. Susan Suarez, where she was trying to demonstrate how you could have moving from the unhealthy to the healthy. So in this one, all you have is a little sweetie, 4 biscuits, and a soda, and you end up with, you end up with 675 calories. And on the far right, she's giving you a little promo done. So she have a Grace porridge here. You end up with 380 calories. All right? So the fact remains is that the ones on the left are not very filling, but one thing that they do provide you with is lots of calories. She also went on to show us how it is that we could fulfill the requirements to have 4 to 6 servings of vegetables per day. So if you wake up in the morning, have a little callaloo with an orange, you're good to go. In the afternoon, you snack on some broccoli and some tomatoes, 3 slices of tomato, you're good to go. And then in the evening, you have your little bowl of vegetables and your knees buried, you're good to go. All right? Not me, Susie's the one who did this. So remember, we're talking about your balance, right? So your intake must be equal to your output. So whatever you consume in must be equivalent to what goes out for you to maintain this balance. So for those of you who like cheesecake, you're putting in 710. All right? And to get back out that 710, you have to go on this bicycle for 2 hours and 21 minutes. All right? We're not stopping you from eating your cheesecake, you know. Go ahead and have your cheesecake. But, you know, you have a two-hour workout later on. Then, this is our box lunch. You know, one of the challenges that we face in this country is that, and I'm not making any excuses for them, but we often blame fast foods for our ills and the fact that we're getting fat. And so you'll often see in the literature that is the preponderance of all of these fast foods, and you all know them, that is causing us to get fat. But the truth be told is that we have far more liquor cook shops than we have fast foods in the so-called traditional sense. And these liquor cook shops, they're in the ramp when it comes to giving you the calories, just like the big guys. All right? So when you go to your liquor cook shop and you order your chicken, your fried chicken, and your rice, and they give you a pasta instead of vegetables, you end up with almost 1,000 calories. Because guess what? First thing first is that they're going to give you the chicken and the rice in the liquor box. And you have different type of box these days. Now you have the doggy box and you have the big box. But even with the doggy box, when they give you that one, it can't close. But the issue is that you swim. So they give the rice, your meat kind, and then they fill it up with gravy. Right? So at the end of the day, the rice will swim. Right? And the fact remains that the oil is 9 calories per gram. So even if you only had a little bit of rice, the fact of the matter is you have all of this oil, you have doubled the amount of calories that you have actually consumed. And so it is not surprising that when we actually take these cook lunches and actually measure the energy contents for them, they're actually quite high. You can easily from a lunch get 1,000 calories. All right? Easily from 1,000 calories. And then when you put on top of that, you know, some sodas, a typical soda is between 150 to 200 calories. You see where we are. And some people, because them feel bad, they say, okay, they're going to take the diet soda. But the long and short is that they're still getting close to 1,000 calories anyway. All right? Or they said, okay, they don't want no water because the water tastes bad. So they will take these, what do you call it? Cran water and all of those nice fancy stuff, which gives you an extra 50 calories. So those are part of the problems that you have. So let us see how we're going to balance out this lunch now. You're going to have to jump and skip for at least an hour. All right? And in addition to that, you're going to have to do some good lunge and bench press. So the long and short about it is that yes, there are some people who are exercising, but you're not really exercising to the amount to balance your inputs. So it's not surprising that a lot of people come to us very frustrated that, listen, nothing will go on for me because we're not making any progress. But the truth be told is that there is a disconnect between what you have to do vis-a-vis what you actually put in so that they balance out. So having had woken you guys up now, we're going to be closing. And so, as I said, one of the challenges that we face is that nutrition covers everyone. And if I was to ask how many nutrition experts there are, it would be equal to the number of persons that are in the room, because everybody has their own belief. Nutrition is something that we all engage in, and so we believe that we are all our own experts. But what I've tried to do is really tell you how we understand it from a science point of view. And hopefully you can actually use that information a little better to understand, to make your own choices. Just to say that I've just chosen about 3 main groups, just to mention a few points about it. In babies, the best food for that baby is breast milk. Breast milk for at least a minimum of 6 months is what the World Health Organization recommends, but we say it's the best food. Babies who are not breastfed, yes, they grow well, but when they get older, they get all kinds of problems, and we're measuring some of those problems as we speak. The transition between breastfeeding and the regular diet can be challenging for the child and the mother. But one of the things that we ask is that weaning food needs to be energy dense. So typical weaning food in the Jamaican context is porridge. The challenge we have with most people in making porridge is that when they're feeding the baby, they feed it with a nipple bottle. And any porridge that can come through a nipple bottle is not worth anything. It's just too diluted. All right? Your porridge should be thick enough that you can cut it with a knife. All right? So that's the issue. Those of us who happen to have survived all the growth agenda and looking forward now to the prosperity one, so we're elderly. One of the challenges that we face is that we end up with what we call weak muscle, and the medical term for that is sarcopenia. And one of the things that we're trying to encourage in our older folks is that they need to increase and ensure that they consume adequate quantities of proteins. And we recommend that it's in the order of about 1 to 1.5 grams per kilogram per day. So if you are roughly a 70-kilo person, which means you're about 150 pounds, you should be eating anywhere between 70 to 80 grams of protein per day in your diet. But more importantly, you want to maintain your muscle strength, and so we encourage you to do some waist training. So not only should you be eating adequate amounts of protein, but as we grow older and we want to limit some of the arthritic pains and stuff that we have, we should be doing some weight training. For those of us who are fortunate or unfortunate enough to be fluffy, one of the things is that there are many prescriptions out there. Some people are going to tell you to go on this Atkins diet. Some people are going to tell you to go on all manner of products. The long and short about it is that we recommend, ultimately, if what you put in is less than what you, if what you spend is more than what you put in, you will lose weight. Most of the studies that have looked at what we call low-carbohydrate-based diets, where they replace the carbohydrate primarily with protein, they tend to show greater efficacy in terms of the weight loss. So that means they're more likely to induce the weight loss. However, the challenge we have most times is the what we call the maintenance phase. That is, most people who end up losing weight have a high likelihood of regaining that weight. And so one has to be consistently working at it. So I'm closing by saying that healthy choices actually means a healthy you. The more you make correct choices in terms of your nutritional choices, the healthier you're likely to be. We recognize that although I looked and spoke primarily about you as an individual and what you can do, certainly the environment needs to be an enabler, a facilitator to enable you to do some of the stuff. So clearly, we need a structure within our society that allows us to be able to feed our infants and our pregnant moms properly. And so our infant policy with the appropriate laws, so for example, I'm lobbying hereby now, Minister, for paternity. Right? Paternity leave. Yes, I need paternity leave too. Even though I don't produce the breast milk, I can at least support the woman who produces the breast milk, right? So we need the appropriate policy that facilitates us feeding our babies properly. Clearly, in order for any of this to work, we have to have proper collaborations between government and industry to promote healthy foods, especially to the vulnerable in our society, which, as I said, primarily, as I spoke to you about, the children and pregnant moms. We also need physical environments that will promote activity. And one of the things that I spoke about, but not in detail, was the fact that in a couple of the slides, we demonstrated that men in general tended to be a little bit more physically active than women. And I'm part of a collaboration with our community health and psychiatry team, as well as the Department of Urban Planning at UTEC, where we have actually looked at how people use the common park. We have only assessed two parks so far, the one in Papin and the one in Emancipation Park. We need some more money. So, Sir Webby, see what you can do for us. But one of the challenges that we face, or one of the observations that we have made, actually, is that there's a great differential in terms of the usage of the parks. Men use the parks far more than women. And there may be many reasons. Certain security may be a reason. It may be also be has to do with how the household is structured. The woman has to go home and fix up so that the guys can come home and eat. But the long and short is that we need to ensure that our physical environments are both safe for both genders, whether male and female, and that the environment is supportive of individuals who need to do exercise. So in concluding, what we can say is that we need to consume a balanced diet that provides your body with all the nutrient requirements from all the food groups. We need to consume the right level of calories, and which, depending on your age and physical activity level, and whether or not you're affected by particular illnesses. We need to strive to make physical activity part of our daily routine. Intensity is just as important as the amount. And what we're saying is that the recommendation is that you really should be aiming for at least 150 minutes of moderate intensity exercise per week. Thank you. Okay.
Oh, take it down.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Okay. I'm inviting Professor Reid to sit there so that he can answer your questions. We have a brief question and answer period. I notice people have already aligned themselves close by the microphone because they want to be sure to get their questions answered. We're going to take 4 questions. Please, the people who are asking questions, could you ask just a single question for me so that others can get their questions in? Can you just state your name and ask the question to Professor Reid for me? And we can start here.
Thank you. Andrea Blackwood Harriet. I need to clarify 2 things before I ask my question. The first thing is the studies between urban and rural population. Did you only study carbs and fats, or did I hear incorrectly? I didn't hear a study of protein intake.
We studied everything. Reported the carbs and fat for this audience, but we studied everything.
Okay. Second question. Is on the nutrition primarily in children?
No. 4% of adults, we think, are on
4%. So the 45% you mentioned, 4% is in adult population.
Yes, ma'am.
All right. Great information. No, I 2 clarifying questions.
All right. Go ahead.
Informational.
Go ahead.
Sorry.
Go ahead. Quickly.
And then.
What's the question?
The question is, in terms of where do you go next with the research, because you're saying just make proper food choices when there's so many other factors now, in particular the chemicals in the food and the implication of carbohydrate in particular and what it does to the metabolic pathways.
All right, so clearly I only had 45 minutes to make a presentation, but I will invite you to join our program at UWE. You spend 18 months and we can tell you, go in some more details. Suffice it to say that as it relates to what else can we do? This is just one component of the many things that we can do. As I said, the purpose of the talk today was not to be prescriptive, but really to start to engage you in general in a conversation about what you eat and to try to provide you with the tools that you can make informed choices for yourself. It's a collective issue because we are all affected by it. We're affected by what our neighbors do. As I told you, we spend roughly $80 billion annually on just hypertension and diabetes. We could have been using that money doing other things. So what our neighbors do as well as what we do is important. And all I'm saying is that we need to start a conversation which basically says we have to start paying attention to things that we eat. All right? And in paying attention to the things that we eat, I've provided a framework for you to gauge what you eat. So what I'm saying is that you need to increase your fruits and vegetables. And if you increase it by 1 or 2 servings per day, that's an improvement. You need to limit the amount of what we call simple sugars that you're consuming. And if you can do that, that's also important. But to facilitate the environment, as I said, it needs a collaboration between private stakeholders, public stakeholders, and ourselves. Because one of the things is that we need to encourage them to make the investments in healthy choices and healthy foods.
Right, thank you. Could I ask the persons who are waiting to give me. I'm going to take three or four questions and then ask Professor Reid to respond.
Go ahead. Go ahead.
Professor, as you said, what we eat is what makes us. But I want you to tell me something about this. A habit I need to break. But what is our calorie intake from a slice of bread, white, and a ripe banana?
All right. Susie, what's a slice of bread? Okay, got that? So about 70 calories.
Yes, Ambassador.
Yes, Ambassador.
thank you, sir, and congratulations for excellent work you've been doing
over
the years. I want to ask you two things for diet. One is Jamaicans have two factors that people are asking about. One is, how come we have the world's fastest athletes? Is it based on some sort of genetic, or does it our diet have anything to do with it? And secondly, our high rate of trauma, murder, would our diet be related to the fact that we have this tremendous rate of
trauma? All right, so the short answer is that the truth be told is that the interaction between diet, let's start this way. We know there's a clear relationship between diet and sports performance, all right? So, which is why a lot of our elite athletes will put them on special diet. Now, whether or not their dietary patterns when they were developing has any impact on that is still open for question, and that's one of the reasons why we started a sports medicine program in terms of research. And so, in another few years, the next GraceKennedy lecturer may be able to answer that question. But it's something that we're actively investigating. So I can't give you a specific answer, but it's one of the things that have been floated around that clearly it might be related to the things and what we eat and how we eat. The other question that you mentioned has to do with whether or not diet plays any role in the incidence of murders or trauma that we have. We recognize, and there's some evidence, both in lab animals as well as in human evidence, that there's a relation, you can modulate brain function through dietary interventions. And therefore, it may be, so I would not rule it out, that there may be a relationship between what we eat and what we call some of the psychological manifestations of our behavior.
Good, thank you very much, sir.
All right, can we have a question?
I have one question. Can somebody tell me quickly what was the revenue reported last year for Grace Kennedy Group?
A lot.
Yes? Can anybody tell me? Roughly? Well, how much? No? It was about 80. $80 billion. And remember the 80 keep coming up? So it costs us $80 billion to manage hypertension and diabetes for a year. And they made $80 billion last year. So it means that all of GraceKennedy money would have been gone to use to manage diabetes and hypertension. Yes, go ahead. Yes.
What is the effect of preservative on the body? And what is the effect of the regularity and the timing and the frequency and the method that the food is taken? So some people are eating in a hurry.
When they are going to bed, then just before that they eat, so, or they are always in a hurry, so they don't even chew it properly. What are the effects of those?
All right, so I'll answer the first one first. So remember in one of the slides I told you what is a diet. A diet consists of nutrients and what we call other compounds. So the other compounds for us refer to any additives, whether it is used in the processing of food or whether it comes from the cooking of the food or the food preparation. What's the effect of the body? We know some of them are actually cancer-causing chemicals, and therefore, when it is that I'm doing the lecture looking at the relationship between diet and cancers, that's when I tend to emphasize those chemicals a lot more. But the issue where that is concerned is that there's a possibility and there's some causal relationship between some of these chemicals and subsequent cancers. The question now has to do with when you eat, is that important? Whether you eat in the morning, noon, or night, whether you eat and so on. The issue is that from a physiological sense, your body undergoes what we call a circadian rhythm. So almost anything that you can think of has a natural pattern to it. So your blood pressure, for example, tends to be highest during the time when you're sleeping, which is why most people die in their sleep, and then goes down during the days. All right? So there's always this pattern. The question is, when you eat, does it affect the pattern? We think there's some small perturbations in it, but on the overall scheme of things, what your body does is really a simple accounting. So after 24 hours, it adds up all that you've consumed over that 24 hours. It doesn't really care whether you had it at 6 in the morning or 6 in the evening, adds up what it does in the 24 hours. And if you're found in excess, it stores it at fat. If you're found in deficit, then it burns off the fat. Remember, there's no time that your metabolic demand is zero. So even when you're sleeping, there's a metabolic demand. All right? Yes.
Good evening, Doctor. Sorry for the hoarse voice.
That's all right.
My name is Dwayne Little. Mm-hmm. And the question that I have is, I'm interested if you were able to pinpoint the amount of processed food that people were consuming in your research, in terms of foods that were taken from tins, especially. Because I'm wondering if there is any difference between probably a pre-independence diet, which probably had less of those, and post-independence diet, which increasingly over time, people will be eating more tin food, especially as we got more urban.
All right, so the long and short about it is that our dietary pattern has changed over time. So what we have said is that when we do our dietary assessments now, the issue is that the main difference is that we're consuming more sugar-containing beverages, higher incidence or consumption of snacks, and yes, we're consuming more of the processed foods. But the issue is, from our definition, anything that you have done, let's start meat, for example, anything that you have done for meat in terms of whether or not to preserve it or to cook it is what we consider to be processing. So it's just a level of processing is different. In the old time, the main processing of meat was to salt it, right? While now, we do other things to it. We'll give it nice, pretty colors. But the issue is that there's always processed foods that have been consumed. Nowadays, what we've found, and when you look at the cancer literature, what it is saying is that, especially talking about meat, is that processed meats, a high consumption of processed meats, is related to the risk of you getting some forms of cancer, like colonic cancers. All right, so we have accepted that. So the vegetarians, or the absolute vegetarians amongst us, have that advantage. They don't have to worry about getting cancer of the colon. But people like me who love meat, I just do my colonoscopy.
All right, let me just interject a question here from one of our persons watching on the internet. They're asking if there's any truth to the fact that eating a lot of ackees could be contributing to Jamaica having the highest incidence of prostate cancer.
Short answer, no. No, no. No. So the short answer to that one is no. That thought emerged from two simple observations. One observation was that men in Jamaica tend to have a high prevalence of cancer. And then the next question is, what do men in Jamaica do differently from the rest of the world? One of the things that we do is that we eat ackee. All right? And so the thought was that ackee may be related to the prostate cancer. The short answer is no.
Okay.
Not hearing.
Not hearing.
Oh, my name is Annette Powell. I wanted to find out in the 70s. Mm-hmm. In the 70s.
Yes.
Dr. George Locke.
Yes.
He was a neurosurgeon at KPH, mm-hmm. and he did some research at UWI, mm-hmm. using white mice, mm-hmm. on the effects of malnutrition on the developing nervous system. Mm-hmm. So I wanted to find out if you have copies of that research and if you could work on it, because as he was a brain surgeon, he would have seen the effect. So he was doing this research. I think he went to California. I saw his picture in the people. Okay. Because that would affect not only maybe even crime and so on, and even the brain, the development of how you know strokes and cardiovascular problems and everything. Okay. So some very important research. I wanted to find out.
We have continued somewhat looking at some of those things. So, right. So the long and short about it is that we have looked at the effects of malnutrition and how you address that on what we call brain development and cognitive development, especially in children. My boss, Professor Walker, has done quite a bit of work on those sort of things.
Okay, so you would know what has happened to his research that he had started.
Not specifically to his work, but in general, what we tend to do is build on what is done in the past.
There, yes. All right. Just breaking thing at that time, you know, it's a breakthrough at the time.
That's fine.
Thank you.
All right. Yes. Sorry.
Hi. Teddy Alexander, JCOB.
Oh. not my fault for you serving time.
Professor Reid. Could you comment on the effect that increased use of computers at work and for entertainment, particularly amongst the younger people, what impact that is having on their development and how we might have to change our diet to accommodate the increased use?
All right. Typically, the anecdotal evidence is that people tend to sit at a computer a lot, snacks a lot. And so what will tend to happen is that the energy expenditure is actually low, but the input is actually high. And so, yes, we do think that, especially studies done in the States where people spend hours and hours on computers and playing games and stuff, says that it contributes to them becoming obese. But the flip side is that you can actually use it, and the physiotherapy department is actually doing that now, where you can actually use it to do exercise. You know, the Nintendo ones and that make you moving up and down and all that sort of stuff. So the long and short is that you can actually make it to be creative and to be good. But the general literature would suggest that that's one of the factors that is contributing to the increased prevalence of obesity in the younger population.
All right, thanks. We have two questions more. Yes?
Yes, yes, ma'am.
Good evening.
Are you an adult, old girl?
Yes, I am an adult.
That's all right. Go ahead.
Oh, sorry.
Go ahead.
I have a six-month-old that I exclusively breastfed. Mm-hmm. He's going into the seventh month now, and I'm introducing a taste of fruits to him. Mm-hmm. Now, I heard you made your recommendations on weaning from breast milk to porridge. I want you to explain that some more, because I don't understand breast milk to porridge. And I actually...
Go ahead. I'm hearing you. Go ahead. Ignore it. Go ahead.
I watched a similar presentation that informed me that children are not able to digest complex carbohydrates until their molars are up. What is your take on that?
All right. So, very interesting sets of questions. So, first thing first, congratulations. The good possibility that your child will be a bright fellow. All right? And that he will grow lean, all right? So the issue is that if you manage to breastfeed him for 6 months, there's a good possibility that that a child grows, he's going to grow slim and he's going to grow bright. So that's very good. The second part of your question, which is a problem for a lot of parents, is the weaning process, what to introduce them with and so on. The point I was actually making was that in the weaning process, one of the challenges that you face is that you want to continue them to continue to grow at a similar rate, that rate compared to when they were on breast milk. And so the point I was making is that in the Jamaican context, the most common weaning foods that we use tend to be porridge. But the point I was making is that when using porridge, one has to be careful that you don't give them a product that has relatively low energy density because they won't grow well. So that was actually the point I was making. Now, in terms of weaning food, most weaning foods are going to be cereal-based foods. That's just how it is. But irrespective of whichever one you use, the important consideration for you as a mom is to try to ensure that you're providing them with adequate amounts of energy. So if you're using a commercial one, then you would have to read the labels to see what the amount of energy that it contains. Or if you're making your own one, whether it be hominy, cornmeal, or oats, or whichever one, you need to ensure that a simple marker of how good it is how thick it is. All right, that's basically it. You know, in terms of the complex carbohydrates and so on, the fact remains is that infants, as they grow older, are able to digest things better. So there is a phenomenon we call capacity to do. And so in general speaking, in general terms, and that goes not only for carbohydrates, it also goes for protein. So in general, what we will tend to do is that when they're younger age, we tend to give them food stuff that a little bit sweet and a little bit simple, not too complex, but as they get older, we can introduce to them far more complex things. So at 6 months, as I said, you can do any one of the cereal stuff that you want. It really and truly, it doesn't really matter. As I said, it's mostly the entry density that is important.
Right, we have...
Yes?
I said one more, but...
Come on, that's all right, any more. Come, bring them on.
Yes, but we have to stop. Have to stop.
Yeah, hi, doctor, how are you? Yeah, great. The usage of GMO products and gene editing, right? Like Monsanto company, Roundup. I know AgriGrace is one of the distributors. That's kind of altering the genes of our natural foods. And it could have, you know, serious implications. And it is having serious implications now. I notice you guys advertise a lot of different insecticides, herbicides, pesticides, weedicides, et cetera, et cetera. Right now, I came in late, but right now, the future, 20, 30 years after, are we going to be a nation of cancerous people?
All right, so the question is GMO, genetically modified foods, and so on. All right, so change is a hell of a thing, eh? One of the challenges that we have is that whenever something is introduced, it creates quite a bit of anxiety. And part of it is that we're not very comfortable with it. We don't have enough data yet to see whether or not it is going to be good or whether or not it is going to be bad.
Yeah, I'm sorry, let me interject. It has been blamed on hyperactivity in kids in America, like Tyson Foods and the cereals, right. Kellogg's and all those.
So there are different types of studies. So I didn't go through this, all right? So whenever it is that you look at evidence, you have to look at evidence in what we call a critical manner. In our system of judgment, when we're looking at evidence, one of the first clues that we may have that something is related is what you call association study. And I give a classic example, one with Aki and Jamaican men. You look at that and you say, okay, you notice what is common in both groups, and you may say that there may be an effect. But you have to take it on other steps. So you will have to go to the stage where you can actually provide some experimental proof that what you have observed is actually related to your outcome. So in this case, for example, you have made an observation that individuals who are hyperactive may have consumed more GMO foods. And that's fine. That's a reasonable observation. The next step now is that you have to take it to another level, which is you now then have to say whether or not you can reproduce in a controlled environment, giving them this food and noticing that effect. Otherwise, from that, it's just an observation without much supporting data.
Okay.
So the long and short about it is that with anything new, there's always going to be a potential harm as well as potential good. When hypertensive medications first came on the scene, this is the same cry. Are they going to be good or are they going to be bad? But as studies go on, we realize that the benefit far outweighs the risk. So where these foods are concerned, time will tell us as we do more and more experiments. Yes, go ahead.
Yes. Is it my turn?
Yes.
Well, just saying that maybe... My name is Georgia Kennedy. Mm-hmm. My husband's STGC. I'm the mother of three who are breastfed till at least the age of 1 year, mm-hmm. and grandmother of six, and they're all breastfed. There's a lot of people who could influence Jamaican policy on two counts. Just to back up my speaker who just went ahead of me, we should be looking at limiting insecticides in Jamaica. It's so tiny. Everything goes into the ground, and everything gets ingested. The second thing about policy would be, why can't we have something that would bring down the cost of diabetes and hypertension, and that is increasing the length of maternity leave so that mothers could nurse for a year?
That's a possibility.
And the cost, upfront cost, would outweigh the eventual loss.
Mm-hmm.
Do you agree with that policy of a year?
No, and I also
joining the rest of the world and giving mothers a year off.
I agree. I don't have a problem with that. I don't have a problem with that. And he could have put in 6 months for the men.
The last question over there, Professor Reid.
Oh, is that an Andrews girl?
Yes.
Oh, my sympathies.
Yes.
What? Hello. I was just wondering if mental activity has anything to do with energy expenditure in terms of your metabolic rate.
Short answer is not really. Short answer is not really. And the reason why I'm so hesitant is the flip is not absolutely true. So for example, individuals who suffer from significant head injury or head trauma, they waste away very rapidly, very quickly. And one of the reasons is that their energy requirements is high when you're in hospital with a significant head trauma. But if you're talking about a normal, healthy individual, just comparing energy expenditure from, say, your brain vis-a-vis the rest of your body, the numbers are not that great. So the short answer is that if you're just going to hope to do, you know, mental arithmetic and stuff and hope that you can use that to increase your energy expenditure so that you can not gain weight, the short answer is that you're going to fail.
Okay. Thank you very much. Please let us applaud Professor Reid. Thank you. I'm going to now ask Mrs. Caroline Mahfood to take us through the presentation of awards.
Had a great lecture, and I'm sure there'll be more questions being posed. You can pose them online or on Twitter at GK Cares, and hopefully we can answer them for you, or we'll get Prof to answer them on our behalf. I need my team to come forward. Crystal, Gail, and Marjorie, if they can come forward now, please, somebody call them. Okay. So over the past 94 years, Grace Kennedy, through Grace Foods, has placed great emphasis on providing wholesome, nutritious, and delicious food products. For all of us, the name Grace is synonymous with quality. This year, based on the topic of the lecture, we decided to do something special leading up to the lecture. We launched a Choose My Plate competition, which targeted schools that have a food and nutrition lab and offer this subject at the CSEC level. Teams were required to submit a short video of them preparing a nutritious meal with a budget of $2,000 or less, using, of course, Grace products. 23 schools entered the competition, and we were very pleased with the entries we received. In fact, it was very difficult to select the winning schools. All of the teams should be very, very proud of what they accomplished, and we'd like to especially thank Grace Kitchens for their guidance and advice, and to their nutrition consultant, Kirk Bolton, who served as the lead judge. Since it was an online competition, we awarded a grant of $25,000 for lab equipment to the school that received the most likes for their video. And that school is St. Jago High School. We would like to invite Mrs. Colette Price, the principal of St. Jago High School, and her little group of students to come forward to accept the award, and Professor Leah Ryan, if you could present this for us. Where we need to. Thank you. They did an outstanding video, and it was very close. They could have won the competition, very close. And now for our county winners, because we felt like we couldn't just give one prize to one winning school. We felt like we should spread it across the island. So the winning school from each county will get $75,000, a grant, towards their food and nutrition lab. And one special highlight for this competition is a kind sponsorship from Hilo food stores. Each member on the team and the teacher will receive a $5,000 gift voucher from Hilo Foods. So, as I announce the county winner, I would like you to take a look at the screen. We've done a little summary because the videos were about 5 minutes long, so we did a little clip for you to get an idea of what they did. And then I'll ask the school to come forward to accept their prizes. Okay. Oh, I should tell you, the first school from the county of Cornwall, the winning school was from the parish of Westmorland, the Godfrey Stewart High School. So we can play the video.
Godfrey Stewart presents Choose My Place.
Hello, welcome to Choose My Place. Today, grade 11 students will be preparing nutritious and economical meals for the family using Grace products. Our menu for today is steamed roast mackerel and beans, pina colada potato, checkered vegetable salad, fiesta dressing, and au revoir drink.
Today I'll be preparing pina colada for dinner.
Amanda is the name, and the drink will be your guest today, Amanda. What are you preparing for us today?
Well, today I will be preparing a very healthy drink.
Okay, so I'm going to ask Professor Leah Ryan if you can come forward again, and Renee Nathan from Hilo Food Stores. So Professor Leah Ryan is going to present them with their $75,000 grant. And a plaque. Marjorie. And we have a gift basket for the teacher as well, because, you know, she has to carry home some more products. And then this is Renee Nathan, the general manager of Hilo Food Stores, presenting their gift vouchers. Congratulations, Renee. Okay, so the winning school from the county of Middlesex and the parish of St. Catherine is Charlemont High School. I want to show you the video.
Food be your medicine, your medicine, your food. Blend up your carrot to the lettuce in a...
Carrot items we'll be using to prepare our meal.
Big deal, you're my friend, I'm a big deal. Yeah, we're kinda important, for real. Oh yeah, I'm a big deal, and my friends are some big deals. Very, very, very important, for real. This has nothing to do with money or fame or vanity. This one is all about self-worth. So big up your chest and stand proud, and don't matter about nobody, no man, no more than no man upon this earth. So whether you walk or you a drive car, I tell you if you're white or black like that, me feel good in yourself, you star. Push up on the one and tell all the haters, I'm a big deal. Yeah, my friend, I'm a big deal. I'm if you tell you, yeah, we're kinda important.
Okay.
For real. Oh yeah, I'm a big deal.
Believe me,
my friends are some big deals.
Okay.
Very, very, very important.
Poor Barry.
For real.
It's like you have the prime minister, and then you have way. That's at the other in a few.
These are the finished dishes.
I rock it, ask anybody about it.
4 points out of the great pint average, and we never cheat or copy if you get it. You know you have your dreams and nobody can stop it. Just walk out, bust a blank and say
I'm a big deal.
Very big deal.
I'm a friend, I'm a big deal.
And Professor Shirley, could I ask you to come up and make this presentation for us? And Renee, you should just stay up here with us, please. And the you can give him the basket now, so that it's in the picture. Yeah. Thank you, Professor Shirley. Okay, and our final winner from the County of Surrey, from Mountain View Avenue, the winner is Excelsior High School.
Welcome to Excelsior High School. We're entering the Grace Choose My Plate competition, and I'm Missy Fanny Cunningham, one of the educators of food, nutrition, and health. I will now introduce you to my team that will be representing.
I'm Chantal Shirley.
I'm Amos.
I'm
Sasha. And I'm Corey Pigeon. Since 1923, Grace has focused on splendid products that are tasty, more affordable in comparison to other products, and are still getting its quality.
Come on, you. We're now going to take you on our culinary journey. Here we are in our Excelsior Eagle Preparation Lab. And our course today will be our three-course menu. And we have the lovely Chantel that will be working on the appetizer. So today, Chantel will be making for us Grace Jerk Sausage Ravioli with a Grace Tomato Sauce. And I'm very much looking forward to that. And the main course will be Grace Sausage Fondue Balls with... And Tashley will be making for us today Rice Yashi and Grace Tossed vegetable salad in sweet pepper sauce.
Well, using the main ingredient, Grace coconut milk, that contains all the nutrients that a normal coconut has, I will now complete the meal by producing
forward. Yes, please. Isn't it great? They were all so creative, very impressive. Renee, why don't you just go in the picture for me? Just pose in the picture. Congratulations, everyone that entered. And if you get a chance, at the end of the lecture, you'll see the actual food that they made on the tables outside and the videos from all the other schools that participated as well. Because, like I said, many, many schools did very well. It was very, very difficult to pick our winners. And Marvin didn't enter, so. Yeah. Oh, Arden, well. The presentation this evening challenged us to consciously think about our dietary choices in order to ensure that we live long, healthy lives. In fact, the Choose My Plate competition reinforces the fact that healthy, nutritious meals can be made inexpensively while having a positive effect on our life, on our health. So I guess we're all going to avoid the refreshments outside right after. We're going to start tomorrow, Marvin. We're starting tomorrow. As you heard in the introduction, Professor Reid has major responsibilities at the University of the West Indies as a researcher, a lecturer, and the director of the TMRU. Preparing for the lecture is no small task, and it requires a lot of sacrifice. Of course, he could not have done it without the support of his family. And I would like to invite Antoinette Brown, his partner, to come forward and to receive a thank you gift from us. Surprise. You can present it. Oh, no, I'm sorry. Forgive me. Mr. Webby, could you please come forward? You can stay, sir. Finally, we want to use this opportunity to thank Marvin for the time he took to produce the lecture book and for his presentation today. It was really great. And so, Marvin, we needed you actually to stay and come forward. Mr. Webby, Professor Shirley, and Professor Liran, if you could join us for this picture, please, and for this presentation. Thanks again. And we'll see you next year, same time. And I'm going to just invite Mrs. Faye McIntosh to come forward and do the vote up thanks.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm certain we're all agreed that Professor Marvin Reid's presentation this evening was outstanding. And he gave us much food for thought in terms of our chosen lifestyle and dietary patterns. Thanks again, Professor Reid. The discussions that followed, the vibrant discussion, already demonstrates that we have been captivated by the rich data shared and are mindful of what is required for individual well-being, as well as the nation's well-being. Remember, healthy choices mean a healthy you. It is our hope that this discussion will continue outside of these walls, and so printed copies of the lecture will be distributed to schools and libraries across the island. For persons watching the live stream, or for any friends that were unable to attend the lecture, please note that the ebook will be available online, free of cost, at gracekennedy.com. This evening's lecture presentation can also be viewed on your YouTube page, Grace Kennedy Cares. We must thank the team that has worked exceedingly hard on the production of the lecture book. Our editor, Charmaine McKenzie, worked closely with Prof. Reid to ensure that the book was completed in time for today's lecture. And Richard Schofield of Phoenix Printery, who ensured that we received the books with time to spare. Special thanks to our graphic artist, Dale Beckford, who designed the cover of the book and all of the advertising for this event. As usual, he did an outstanding job. We must also express our thanks to those who worked behind the scenes to prepare the attractive setting in which we enjoyed the lecture. Year after year, the team from Hip Hop Tents, led by Mrs. Carol Gray, transforms this room to create a beautiful and harmonious space. We thank Maxine McDonough, our public relations consultant, Scan Media for photography, Mark White and his team from Visual Tech, who provided the sound, videography, and online streaming of the lecture to YouTube. And of course, our host, the Pegasus Hotel, for a wonderfully convenient venue and delicious refreshments that we will enjoy shortly. To our immediate family, the members of the Grace Kennedy Foundation Board, thank you for providing the support we need to perform. To the members of the Secretariat, Executive Director, Carolyn Mahfood, Mrs. Carolyn Mahfood, and her team, who have worked unceasingly to ensure that no detail was overlooked. Most importantly, we thank each and every one of you for taking the time to be here with us and contributing to the amazing energy and vibrancy of this evening's discussion. We are grateful and humbled by the consistent growth of our audience in numbers, as well as diversity. It shows that we are indeed on the right path. We ask that you continue the discussion in your offices, schools, churches, and communities. We now wish you God's journey and mercies as you travel to your respective homes. Thank you.